Spin and the Bloch equations, named after Felix Bloch, whom you see down here, they underlie all MRI. And users and developers, they need understanding of these concepts. So today's focus is understanding of basic MR, and since this is a lecture for physicists, I will include elements of quantum mechanics, even though it is not really needed for understanding basic MR. The content of today is classical magnetic resonance and the role of spin, the Bloch equations, and the effective field vector. I will talk about interactive MR visualization in a browser, and I will discuss the relation to quantum mechanics, and then I will do some myth busting. The take home messages. First of all, spin dynamics are simpler than you may think. The Bloch equations, they form the basis for MRI, and rotating frames of reference, they help understanding the dynamics immensely. Visualization tools, they can help you learn and teach spin dynamics. Spin is a quantum effect, but the dynamics are as expected classically. Myths are abundant, however, and they contradict some example truths. The nuclear spin can point in any direction. Quantum jumps play no role in NMR or MRI. And homogeneous fields, they will rotate the spin distribution as a whole. Atomic nuclei are not spinning charged spheres, as you see here. However, they behave as spinning charged spheres, except for all protons being equally magnetic. And I therefore really like this picture, even though it is too simple. It gives you great predictive power, since the nuclear magnetization with respect to MR behaves as you would expect it to, based on that proton drawing. For example, the protons are magnetic, and if you place them in a strong magnetic field, B0, then you will get a certain degree of alignment, and therefore a spin polarized sample. You may have learned a quantum description of this, and actually that is not really needed, since quantum mechanics predict the same dynamics as classical magnetic dipoles. However, quantum mechanics is convenient for calculation of the equilibrium magnetization, for example, but you will get the same result if you do a semi-classical calculation. Next, I will introduce magnetic resonance, and I will do it in a simulator capable of exploring both compass magnetic resonance and nuclear magnetic resonance. It runs directly in a browser, and you are invited to try the demonstrations yourself. You here see a compass needle aligned with a magnetic field, B0. When it is given a push, it will generate an oscillating voltage in the coil that is sensitive to field changes orthogonal to B0. This voltage is the MR signal. If I apply a weak orthogonal magnetic field to the needle, it will be pushed slightly away from equilibrium. If I do repeated pushes matched to the natural oscillation frequency, like this, then I can exploit magnetic resonance to get a large effect even though the pushes are gentle. To avoid moving parts, I can generate the oscillating field with a coil and subsequently use the same coil to detect the signal. Nuclei do not behave exactly as compass needles, since they have angular momentum spin. But they can still be excited with an oscillating magnetic field matched to the resonance frequency, the Lama frequency. Unlike compass needles, the nuclear resonance frequency is independent of oscillation amplitude, hence the nuclei can be excited more than 90 degrees. We can derive the equation of motion for the nuclear spin using classical mechanics. The magnetic moment mu is proportional to the spin angular momentum j, as you would expect for a rotating charge distribution, and the constant of proportionality is called gamma, that is the diamagnetic ratio, which is just a constant. The angular momentum that changes when a torque is applied, so from Newtonian mechanics we have dj dt is equal to tau, where tau is the torque. We can calculate that using the cross product. We can take mu cross b, and that brings us to the resulting equation of motion for a nuclear magnetic moment, which we get when we combine these equations here. Then we have the mu dt is equal to gamma mu cross b. So that tells us that the magnetic moment mu that changes in a direction that is orthogonal to both mu and to the applied magnetic field b. And this describes precession, which is a circular motion happening at a frequency gamma times b. Up here I call the magnetic moment from mu Down here I'm calling it M. Since nu, that was the magnetic moment of the individual nuclei, but what we have in a voxel, for example, that is a large collection of many nuclei. And hence, the total magnetization M is just the vector sum of all the individual magnetic moments. Since each of the nuclei obey this equation here, then also the sum magnetization will obey the same equation of motion. So we are left with the equation dm dt is equal to gamma m cross b0, where in this case I have taken the magnetic field to be the static magnetic field b0. The equation of motion is similar to that of a spinning top or a gyroscope. The fast spin of the brass plate makes the spin axis slowly precess around the gravitational field. The equation of motion for the total magnetization was derived under an assumption of all nuclei experiencing the same magnetic field. However, due to nuclear interactions, that is not the case. The nuclei interact magnetically, and the dipolar coupling causes both dephasing and random changes in excitation angle. Hence, we end up with the Bloch equations describing precession at the Larmor frequency proportional to the field strength, and on a longer timescale, there is longitudinal relaxation back towards equilibrium m0 on a timescale t1, and transversal relaxation back to a different equilibrium 0 on a timescale t2. Importantly, the individual nuclei do not return to equilibrium. They each precess in the magnetic fields, as you see here, disturbed slightly by weak interactions with other nuclei. Hence, they are gradually reoriented randomly, which brings the sample as a whole back to Fermi equilibrium. I will now visualize some special cases of particular interest using another simulator. Once again, it runs directly in a browser, and you are invited to try doing the simulations yourself. I have a few slides describing the layout of this so-called Bloch simulator that you see here. However, I will not go through these slides since I will demonstrate the simulator instead. But if you want additional detail, you can pause the video or browse the syllabus. In the demonstrations, you will see the dynamics described by the Bloch equations for fields that are manipulated interactively. This includes the polarizing field B0 and the RF field B1. You here see a magnetization vector precessing in a magnetic field. It has a longitudinal component along the direction of the B0 field that is here vertical. And it has a transversal component in the orthogonal plane, here illustrated by the shadow on the floor. The MR signal is shown in the upper graph. The red curve is the coil voltage generated by the precession, and the white constant curve is the signal amplitude corresponding to the length of the shadow on the floor. Let's start in equilibrium, where the magnetization is longitudinal. With an RF pulse on resonance, the magnetization is rotated into the transversal plane. In real life, T1 and T2 are sample properties, but since this is a simulation, we have flexibility. Relaxation is currently disabled, for example, but we can now introduce it. Setting T2 to 6 seconds, for example, makes the transversal magnetization decay away on this timescale. Setting T1 to 8 seconds makes the longitudinal magnetization independently approach M0 on this longer timescale. For both kinds of magnetization, the approach to equilibrium is exponential. But remember that longitudinal and transversal magnetization have different equilibrium values. We can now give a second RF pulse and see T1 and T2 relaxation in action simultaneously. Different tissues have different relaxation times. In the lower left, you can choose an initial condition of mixed matter. Giving a 90 degree pulse, you can see magnetization vectors for white matter, blue matter, and green matter. They each return to equilibrium on different timescales, and it is left as an exercise for you to determine these. For each tissue type, you can determine whether T1 and T2 is relatively long or relatively short. When you have determined the relative T1s and T2s, you can try to establish the relative proton densities that are proportional to the tissue's equilibrium magnetizations. You have seen how the macroscopic magnetization evolves when it is left alone in a field after excitation. It precesses and it relaxes back towards equilibrium. Now I will discuss the spin distribution, and I will take a classical approach that will turn out to be meaningful from a quantum perspective also. In absence of field, the spin distribution is uniform over directions as illustrated in these two figures. When the sample is placed in a static B0 field, the distribution becomes skewed in the direction of the applied field. The spins tend to align with the field, but the nuclear interactions are very energetic compared to the spin energy, so the degree of alignment is very small, typically in the ppm range. On a timescale T1, a net magnetization appears. Now the spin distribution is slightly skewed and described by the Boltzmann distribution. A second effect of the applied field is that all the nuclei starts precessing at the Larmor frequency. Since the magnetization is longitudinal, there is no energy radiated, however, so only thermal fluctuations will be detected. When an oscillating RF field is added, the situation becomes more complex. Here it is shown how the magnetization precesses around B0 and simultaneously around an orthogonal B1 field vector that is itself rotating at the Larmor frequency. The reddish arrow shows the precession around B1. It is seen how the entire spin distribution is rotated, so the net magnetization follows. It can be rotated in any direction, for example into the transversal plane or back near equilibrium. Since the precession around B0 is fast and common to all nuclei, it makes sense to change to a frame of reference rotating at the RF frequency. In this frame, only the precession around B1 remains. Please note that the animation here shows the effect of a resonance rotating B1 field. The simple loop coil that you saw before cannot generate such a rotating field. It will instead generate a linearly polarized field. However, this can be decomposed into two circularly polarized fields rotating in opposite directions. One of them will be rotating together with the precession and will therefore be close to resonance. The other can safely be ignored since it rotates opposite the Larmor precession and is therefore very far from resonance. The simple consequence is that nuclei behave as if subject to circularly polarized fields even when they are not. In the rotating frame of reference, the corresponding B1 field vector is stationary. Before exploring this further using the simulator, I will describe such RF field interactions in more detail and extend to the case of non-resonant RF. The focus is initially on the special case of magnetization interaction with a rotating B1 field vector of constant amplitude. However, the relevance is general, as a more complicated RF pulse, such as the pulse shown here, can be decomposed into a train of constant amplitude pulses. Another adopted simplification is to ignore relaxation, since most RF pulses are short compared to the relaxation times. On the previous slide, it was shown that for a resonant field, the dynamics are simplified when changing to a rotating frame of reference. Even for non-resonant fields, this is still the case. If the frame of reference is chosen to rotate at the RF frequency, then the adapted Bloch equations describe precession around a constant effective field vector. The field vector has two contributions as shown here. The transversal component is the stationary RF field vector, but for a pulse that is not applied on resonance, there is remaining precession in the transversal plane due to the frame rotation not matching the Larmor precession exactly. This is expressed in the longitudinal component of the effective field vector, the detuning given by the frequency offset between the Larmor frequency and the applied RF. These concepts will now be explored in the Bloch simulator. Here you see precession once again. Let's change to a frame of reference rotating at the Larmor frequency. You still see the precession, but from a different point of view. This is reflected in the rotation of the floor. In this rotating frame of reference, the magnetization is now stationary, so the B0 field appears to be transformed away. I now switch back to the stationary frame of reference and choose the equilibrium initial condition. Let's see how a 90-degree pulse affects the magnetization. The purple bar is the torque from the B1 field, which indicates in which direction the magnetization is pushed by the RF pulse. At resonance, these pushes consistently increase the excitation angle. Let's see it again. I start in equilibrium. and apply an oscillating B1 field sufficiently long to rotate the magnetization 90 degrees. Now let's see the same 90 degree pulse in the frame of reference rotating at the RF frequency. First I go to equilibrium and change the frame of reference. Then I apply the 90 degree pulse and you will see the effective field vector as a blue bar. You see that the magnetization processes around the effective field vector, which is transversal since the pulse is applied on resonance. If I apply another 90 degree pulse, I can rotate the magnetization further, for example to invert it. In general, the RF field is not applied on resonance. During slice selection, for example, a field gradient is applied, so some nuclei will be on resonance while others will not. I will introduce a spatial distribution of nuclei and a field gradient as shown for the human head. Think of the row of nuclei that you see here as those between the ears, for example. A constant gradient is applied, but that is not visible until excitation that I initiate now. I pause the simulation here after excitation to examine the result. Since the field varied between positions during excitation, the effective field vector is pointed in different directions for different nuclei, and only on resonance was it transversal. That was in the middle, and those nuclei are therefore excited 90 degrees. Above and below resonance, the effective field vectors was near parallel to B0, and the corresponding nuclei were therefore excited little. This is how slice selection works. Please note that we get little signal from the slice, however, since the directions vary between positions. We can remove the so-called phase roll or phase ramp by inverting the gradient briefly as indicated in the sequence diagram. I invert the gradient and resume simulation until the nuclei are in phase. You now see the resulting slice profile on the floor. I zoom out to show that it is sink-like even though 90 degrees is not a small tip angle. To give a better impression of the effective field vector, I will now show so-called adiabatic inversion used to apply 180 degree pulses fairly independent of the B0 and B1 amplitudes. The idea is to start the RF pulse far from resonance and then do a frequency sweep through resonance. I start in equilibrium and go to the rotating frame. Then I adjust the RF frequency far from resonance. I now turn on a weak B1 field. Since it is applied far off resonance, the effective field vector is near longitudinal initially and the magnetization processes around it. When I ramp up the B1 field amplitude gradually, the magnetization will therefore follow the effective field vector. Now I am applying a strong field far off resonance. I now gradually sweep the field through resonance and finally decrease the amplitude. The result is an approximate inversion of the magnetization, which at all points stayed close to the effective field vector. Ta-da! In the last part of this talk, I will discuss the relation between classical and quantum descriptions of MR and address some typical misunderstandings. On the previous slides, I introduced magnetic resonance, and there are, of course, good alternative ways of introducing it. There are also bad ways, however, and I will now warn about a common misleading description. It goes like this. In absence of field, the directional distribution is uniform. When we apply a magnetic field, B0, then quantum mechanics tells us that nuclei will align parallel or anti-parallel to the field. There will be a surplus in the spin-up state, like this. And then when we apply radio waves, the population is moved to the spin-down state, and when they return to spin-up, then we have emission of radio waves. This is sometimes visualized in this way as cones. you see here thermal equilibrium, and when we apply radio waves, we end up with this superposition of the up and down state. This is all nice and simple, however, it's largely wrong, it's unsupported by quantum mechanics, and it opens more questions than it answers. If you believe this explanation, you should try to answer these exam questions from hell. For example, if the picture on the upper right is correct, then why do we get zero signal after applying an inversion pulse when starting from thermal equilibrium? The correct answer is that the expressed quantum interpretation is wrong. Many of the misunderstandings of MR can be traced back to some well-known aspects of quantum mechanics. Microscopic systems such as atoms can only exist in discrete states with specific energies. Transitions between these states happen in sudden quantum jumps and involve an exchange of energy. The timings of the jumps are truly unpredictable. Unfortunately, this is high school quantum mechanics dating back to the very early version from 1913. Just a few years later, modern quantum mechanics was introduced. There's nothing wrong with quantum mechanics, of course, we just need to do it right. So how can we reconcile these two descriptions? Basically, we just need to fix the level diagram and introduce the coherent interactions that are responsible for MR. With this small change, the descriptions are actually very similar, even though that may not be clear at present. Does it matter? Yes. Very importantly, the MR signal does not arise from transitions between states, but from superpositions of states. In general, any state psi can be written as a superposition of spin up and spin down. But these states just constitute a particular basis, just like unit vectors in a coordinate system. We might as well have used a left-right basis or any other basis. It is worth noting that there's nothing special about the up-down states, except mathematical convenience. They are not even eigenstates of the measurement operator, and they are unimportant for understanding MR. In particular, all superposition states are possible, and the spin system here actually has the same degrees of freedom as a classical dipole. However, classical mechanics is not everything, and it has shortcomings when you go beyond the Bloch equations, for example to coupled spin systems. Hence, I will now briefly go to the dark side and discuss how to do quantum descriptions of MR. A good starting point is the density operator, which is the outer product of the wave vector with itself. A great feature of this is that it can be averaged over statistical ensembles, and it can express both classical uncertainty and quantum indeterminism. Its evolution is described by the Liouville von Neumann equation rather than the Schrödinger equation. The latter describes wave vector mechanics that is not suited for describing incoherent population transfer such as T1 relaxation. We can now use this equation of motion to determine how the expectation value of the dipole moment will evolve. We end up with an equation for the expectation value of the magnetization, and it looks suspiciously like the Bloch equation. The well-known relaxation terms appear when coupling to infinite degrees of freedom are introduced. Importantly, this equation here is valid even for individual nuclei and for any two-level system. Since the expectation value of the dipole moment behaves classically even for individual nuclei, let's introduce the so-called Bloch vector mu. This allows us to return to the light side while staying true to quantum mechanics. So what is the Bloch vector that is here demonstrated by Luke Skywalker? It was introduced by Feynman and co-workers back in 1957. They showed that two-level systems can in general be understood from classical magnetic resonance. The Bloch vector is an abstract quantum property inspired by MR, and in this case it is simply the nuclear magnetization behaving as expected classically. It points up for the upstate, down for the downstate, and can point in any other direction. So the bottom line here is that the so-called classical description is simultaneously a quantum description. But it has limits. You may get in trouble for spin larger than 1/2 or for coupled nuclei, for example. So how should we interpret an animation like this? From a quantum perspective, we can think of the arrows as Bloch vectors, and the collection of these as illustrating a distribution compatible with the density matrix. As said, there are differences between classical and quantum mechanics. In particular, interference involving cancellation of possibilities, entanglement, which are non-factorizable states, and then quantum mechanics is probabilistic at the most fundamental level. However, the two descriptions can be made quite similar. In particular, superpositions and eigenstates are common concepts, for example. Some final remarks. The Bloch equations, they are incredibly useful, but there's more beyond. For example, for spectroscopy of molecules with J-coupling, you will find the density operator useful. Such a molecule, as shown here for example, is essentially a collection of coupled oscillators. And as for similar classical systems, we end up with a series of resonances. For specifics, go to literature. For example, I can recommend Leavitt's spin dynamics. Also, relaxation is not always monoexponential, as implied by the Bloch equations. Also, motion plays a role, as expressed by the Bloch-Torrey equations, for example. Finally, I want to mention the webpage in the bottom of this slide. It provides the simulators and animations used here, and it gives much more detail on the relation between classical and quantum MR descriptions. Thank you for your attention.